Cool. So, like I said, my name is Brian Gracely. Last session of the day, I promise I will go quickly. We're not going to keep you too much between some sort of adult beverage or a chance to stretch your legs. I have one request I'm going to make, and I'm going to hold it to the end, but I have a sort of a trade-off I want to make for you guys, so sort of hold on to that if you're still here. When we got started doing this three KubeCons ago, so in Seattle, we started doing this, and it was kind of a, you know, we knew we had this community that was kind of building, and we wanted to see if we could get folks together face-to-face, because that's always a good thing to do as opposed to online, and we said, we're going to try this thing out. And I think it fit about from here over. We had roughly 100 people. We did this in Berlin. We had about 200 or so people, roughly. I think today we had, I know I counted this morning, we had room for 250 seats, and we probably had another 30 or 40 in the back. I think we probably were close to 300 people. So first off, thanks for staying for 8 hours. This is fantastic. Thank you very much. But this is becoming a great community. It's actually becoming probably one of my favorite days of the year. We get to do Red Hat Summit, which is big, but this is face-to-face with people, and it's very Kubernetes-focused and very OpenShift-focused. So thank you for being here, first and foremost. We love this community because it's all about collaboration, right? It's technologists. You learn about things that were roadmaps, and you learned about what the government was doing, and you know, really highly regulated industries. You learned about kind of the future of what's going on with the edge, with mobile. You learned about where people are going. It's a great community to collaborate. A lot of times we'll have these events and people will kind of get somewhere into it and they go, ah, it's not for me. There's 10 other things going on. If folks weren't here, they were out in the hallway. They were collaborating about something, which is very, very cool. So we've seen a lot of collaboration happen. I think we're up to 300 different companies that are part of the OpenShift Commons, which is awesome. And it's a community that allows you freedom to innovate. We don't charge you to be part of the community. You come, you bring your knowledge, you bring your ideas, you bring code, whatever you want to bring. We wanted to make this open and innovative. And while OpenShift ultimately brings a lot of things together in terms of integration, it's still very much a composable platform. It allows you to say, I want to work with this sort of storage, I want to work with this sort of monitoring, I want to work with these types of applications and frameworks, and we allow you to do that. And we don't say, no, you can't do that because it's not the default, it's in OpenShift. We allow you to do that. So that has continued to be very, very cool. If you get a chance, talk to the partner companies that are out in the hallways, in this hallway, in the back hallway as well. They're very, very anxious to sort of work on these types of problems with us, and it's been great to see them continue to want to integrate around what we're doing in Kubernetes and also in OpenShift. I hope what you heard today was that this is very real. These are just a few of the customers that spoke at Red Hat Summit. You can look at this and pretty much take any industry that you're in, whether it's automotive, banking, airlines, transportation, pharmaceuticals, you name it, government. There is a production customer doing this in pretty much every geography around the world. So we've been very lucky to have customers that trust us with their production workloads. Got a call from one of the banks in Europe this week, said they were doing 800,000 transactions a day, hoping to be at 1 million by the end of the week and 2 million by the end of the month. Right, a lot of interesting stuff going on there. We've got railroads that are doing 1 million logins to get people's tickets every single day. We've got very cool things going on, like with KeyBank, where on Fridays when you get your paycheck and you worry, like, did I actually get paid this week? They used to have one login a day because people would do it from their work computer and they really weren't sure if anybody was looking to see how much they make. And now they get 10 logins a day because people are just a little anxious about whether or not they're getting paid, and they're solving those sort of problems with Kubernetes. And so we're seeing very cool things happen with containers, we're seeing them happen with Kubernetes, and we're seeing them happen in production. And I hope you got a flavor of that from some of the case studies today. I love this slide. I made this a long time ago because I was like, it went back to, somebody mentioned this morning, how do you explain what we do to our parents or your kids or whatever you do? And I thought about, like, what do our customers do with Kubernetes? Because nobody has a Kubernetes problem. Nobody has a container problem for that matter. And so I started writing them down, and what I found, because I travel quite a bit, was I went, like, how much is this part of my day-to-day life? And what's very cool for me is the company that, so I travel all the time. The company that I make my payments with uses OpenShift. The company that I travel with and stay in their hotels pretty much every other week or every week uses OpenShift. I log in using their key app. I never have to deal with the front desk anymore. My favorite airlines now uses OpenShift, right? The company that I use for ride sharing doesn't use OpenShift, but Lyft is giving technology back to the open, well, not to the OpenShift community, to the Kubernetes community in the way of Envoy, so that even if you're not a taxi company, which not very many of you are, I don't think, but for any of you that has to deal with thousands and thousands of real-time notifications, potentially for your supply chain, potentially for how your customers are going to log in, you get to take all the benefit of what they do. It's going to run on Kubernetes, and eventually it's going to run on OpenShift. And you start to go, okay, this community of people that are working on this stuff, and the other thing is, you know, I'll be in a city, and I'll be listening to commercials on the radio, or I'll be driving down the road, and I'll go, that company runs OpenShift, that company runs OpenShift. And you get this sort of sense of like, okay, this phenomenon is starting to take off quite a bit. We sort of call it this flywheel. And so that's very, very cool for us. It's very rewarding in terms of going like, and Mike Barrett reminds us all the time, like, this is stuff that people are betting their careers on. This is stuff that people are making 5-year, 10-year bets on. You need to be on your game all the time in terms of making it better. And so having you here, giving us feedback about how we make it better, about how we improve it, really, really important to us. And if you get a chance, you know, hit up any of us that are wearing some sort of red shirt, red hat thing out in the hallways, or if you see us all week, hit us up about that. So somebody mentioned this before, you know, the future is sort of here today, right? We live in this pretty amazing age. Cars drive by themselves, Google search is complete by themselves, all sorts of crazy technologies happening. And we now have it at our fingertips, right? 7 years ago, if you'd walked into any CIO's office, you know, you would have somehow seen a Gartner report or something that says, like, we wish we could be as efficient as Google. Like, they've got 1,000 servers and one admin, and we've got like 10 servers and 2 admins, and we're trying to figure stuff out, and we'd love to do proper. And here we are in 2017, and that same technology that people like Google use, that people were dying for, would have given their left arm for, is now free, right? You can get Kubernetes for free, and you can work with people. You know, we saw the folks from Google that were up here earlier. You can work with them. You can talk to them. Google is no longer that company that's just on the other end of a search. Like, you can sit down and talk with those folks, and that's very, very cool. But it's a little bit distributed, right? But here's the cool thing. Here's where we are today. 4, 5, 6 years ago, and anybody of us that were in the platform space, we were building a lot of interesting technology. We were trying to make it interesting for developers, and we all sort of made a whole bunch of mistakes, whether it was we didn't support enough languages, it didn't run enough clouds, it was proprietary, it was all driven by one vendor, whatever it was. And we've all finally, as of last week, we've all finally come around that we're supporting Kubernetes. Like, that's where we're going with this. And the end result of that, even before Amazon's announcement and Oracle's announcement and Microsoft's announcement, is we've built a pluggable innovation platform that allows us to innovate in infrastructure and in applications. And that's very cool. We're not bound by sort of, I want to build microservices, but I'm bound by a monolithic platform, right? We're able to do this in pluggable ways, whether it's pluggable for network, pluggable for monitoring. We're able to run a whole bunch of different applications. Some of them run better than others, but we're getting better at it, whether it's, you know, just, you know, native applications, legacy applications, evolving sort of high-performance applications. We could do all this stuff today, right? That's today. And the question we really have is like, okay, how far along are you in that? Because we'll talk to customers and they'll go, yeah, we're still trying to figure out CI/CD. Cool. At least you're trying to do it. And we'll talk to other customers like the ones that were up on stage. And they didn't tell you, because it's not always cool on stage to say, hey, I have scars and scabs on my knees and stuff. But they're doing it, right? This is possible. This isn't Silicon Valley. This is somebody up in Canada. No offense, Diane. Right? This technology is possible everywhere, which is very cool, right? Now, the other thing we run into, and I was at an event at the New York Stock Exchange last week, and we got into this conversation about, like, where are applications going? And I gave a talk, and the person who went after me said, yeah, that was all great, except, you know, functions as a service and serverless is going to be the end of computing. Like, that's the end of it. That's where we'll all end. There will be nothing past that, because you've broken everything down to the smallest sort of atom of what you can do. And maybe that's true. I don't know, right? I always sort of look at it as, we have this fascination in technology to make everything binary, right? Something new is going to kill everything old. And so we've gone from sort of monolithic applications to microservices to functions. And then we go, well, I don't really know what's next. And that's sort of the application evolution. The reality is, from an architecture perspective, we always sort of having to keep coming back to this, right? We've seen this over and over again in customers that we work with. Yeah, the microservices group, that center of excellence, may have gotten started. And at some point when they've got 30 or 40 applications on the platform, they go, but how are you going to connect it back to the mainframe? How are you going to connect it back to these old Sun systems? How are you going to connect back to the stuff that runs our business, right? And so it becomes this sort of flywheel, right? We have to figure out how to build platforms that support multiple types of applications. And that's ultimately, if you broke down, what have we been doing for the last 3 years? It's, yes, we want to containerize stuff, but we want to run them on a platform that's going to give you a whole bunch of flexibility. And I think we've kind of gotten there, right? The good news is there's lots more coming. Right, there's always more coming. We've been getting much better at containerizing sort of all the platforms, right? We've done it on x86, we've done it on multi-cloud. We, you know, as of next spring and sort of early right now, we're doing it on Windows, We're doing it on GPU. You know, RHEL is now supporting GPU. We're seeing work as working groups on GPUs. We're seeing it in ARM. And, you know, maybe even sort of kind of, we might see it on mainframe as well, right? So, but we're kind of containerizing all the platforms. So we've got that standardization, which is cool. We're seeing the ability to not only do things on the platform, but do them off the platform. I know Mike and others and Paul with the awesome Blue Mohawk talked about the service platform or the service broker and the ability to bring in third-party services. So what do I want to bring into the platform? I can bring in anything I want to. Can I help have visibility to that from an IT perspective? Absolutely. Is this a great way to sort of control shadow IT? Yeah, to a certain extent, right? Developer freedom with a certain amount of control, with compliance and security sort of in that workflow. That's awesome, right? And then we're starting to talk about microservices. I talked about Lyft and Istio, and here's the craziest thing, right? We're now at a stage where companies that, for their job, provide taxi services, and maybe eventually they'll provide transportation services, and we're gonna get technology from them. Huh? I thought I got technology from companies that got a lot of money from VCs. Wait, no, I thought I got it from open source communities. No, I'm getting it from taxi companies. No, I'm getting it from communities, right? That's what this thing is. This is about communities. And we're seeing this technology come along really quickly, and we're able to learn from people that are really changing the world, and they may be doing it in big ways, and you can do it in small ways, but you can get that code, and you can go talk to those people, and that's powerful, right? So, and then, you know, we talk about serverless. The cool thing is there a serverless standard today? No. But is there pluggable ways to do that? Yeah. And you're going to hear about new serverless frameworks that have come out this week. You're going to talk to people that have been doing it already. You may or may not have any applications today that make sense for serverless. But it's a thing where you go, that might make some sense. I should go learn about what functions are doing. And the cool thing is you don't have to go, oh, is Kubernetes and OpenShift going to support that? Yeah, it will. Right? That's the nice thing about this. We've always said we are going to be as good a citizen, as good a community member at Kubernetes as we possibly can. All the work will get done in Kubernetes. The experience will end up being hopefully an OpenShift, but we're going to be as good as we possibly can at Kubernetes. It's great to see all this work happening around serverless as well as all the other frameworks around Kubernetes, right? So all of you benefit from that, which is awesome. So I'm going to wrap this up real quick, and I'm going to remind me I have a favor I have to ask all of you, okay? So the opportunity ahead. So the great thing about this room is it is potential customers, it is systems integrators, it is our technology partners. The opportunity for this is very large, right? We're seeing more and more companies that are saying, I want to embrace containers. We're seeing more and more cloud providers who are saying, bring your applications here. And we're no longer seeing them talk about it as just the cloud and your data center. We're seeing things done in hybrid ways. So for folks that felt like it was a binary decision, like I have to go all to the cloud or I have to stay in my data center, what do I? That's happening. And this technology is really helping. We probably have 60%, 70% of the deals that we work on these days, the customers will say, we will run in our own data center for some amount of applications, and we will run in at least one and maybe two iterations of public clouds. And what they want is they want that flexibility of sort of like their infrastructure, and they want one operational model. And what they're using is OpenShift to do that. They're providing one platform that runs across all these things. And we can talk about examples of that all day long, from, you know, Volvo to Schiphol Airport to Amadeus to you name it, and happy to talk to you guys about that. The other thing is people go like, how do we do this? Like, what's the pattern? Like, is there a, you know, can I line this up with my company? And we sort of found there's four of these. And you may have seen this picture before. We sort of come back to it all the time. People start somewhere in one of these quadrants. They don't always start in the same place. They're not clockwise. They're not counterclockwise. But they start somewhere. Sometimes it's the operations team saying, hey, my developers just want to run containers. We need a container platform. Awesome. OpenShift is great for that, right? We want to start building microservices, and the developers drive that, and they go, we want to run Spring, or we want to run, you know, we're going to play around with Istio, we're going to build something ourselves. Great, this is a platform that's going to support that, whether you want to do existing applications or you want to do new applications. Cool. Sometimes the CIO will say, we're going to build a hybrid cloud, or we're going to evolve a hybrid cloud. Great, we've got examples of people doing that today, like, I need one operational model across geographies, or across prices, or across ML models, whatever it might be, I want to get close to that. And oh, by the way, that service broker is going to make it that much easier, right? I want to make those services that come from the public cloud look like they're native in my platform. And then finally, we do some stuff, some very cool stuff with the Red Hat Innovation Labs, the Open Innovation Labs that are in Santa Clara and Boston and London and going to be in Asia very soon to help you go, that was all cool, how do I get started? And these folks will help you in a couple of weeks or 4, 6, 8 weeks get a minimum viable product up and running, kind of help you figure out the culture a little bit of how to do this Scrum, Agile, CI/CD, buzzword stuff, and make it real, okay? So hopefully somewhere along that you can go, we are somewhere on that dartboard. We may evolve to a bunch of places on that dartboard, but these guys can help us get there, okay? Now, with that, this is where we get to the part where I'm going to ask you a favor. So, did anybody learn anything this week? Did you get anything out of this whatsoever? Was it worth your time at all? Okay. If your hand went up, I want you to stand up, and I want you to give that wonderful lady a round of applause. So, Diane is one of the very, very good people in the community. She works tirelessly to make this happen. We're very thankful that it happened, that it comes off without a hitch. And tonight she will probably sleep incredibly well and probably for the next couple of days. So with that, thank you all for being here. If you get a chance, fill out your survey. If you get a chance, sign up for Commons. This stuff happens all the time. She does a weekly video that you're learning stuff about this. We do weekly podcasts about all this stuff. So thank you very much for all your time. Thanks for all for staying, and we will see you for the rest of the week.
So I just want to take a minute again to thank all of our sponsors and to invite you all to join us at the reception, except for those of you who are out there in Facebook land. Unfortunately, we can't teleport you here, but all of the sponsors will be in the next room over for the next couple of hours so we can network and connect with each other. If you haven't joined the OpenShift Commons yet, come see me. I will hook you up. And if you are interested in earning one of the speaker gifts, the beautiful vests that we have here that you see, and you'll see us walking around in 80 degrees in Austin, probably not appropriate this time of year, but I'm Canadian. And you want to tell your story at the next gathering or in a briefing or somewhere in the virtual world, please let me know and I will make sure you can take the podium and tell your story and give your feedback to the engineers and the contributors and the service providers that are helping us build out this ecosystem. I really appreciate you guys really spending almost 9 hours with us today. It's pretty awesome. The folks that came and gave speeches, thank you very much for that time and the dedication you have to making Kubernetes and OpenShift a wonderful community to work within. So thank you very much. One more thing before you clap. If you didn't get a backpack, we have a few of them left, so please pick one up because the dear sweet Alexa over here, who has been managing everything for us, really doesn't want to pack them and take them home. So Alexa, thank you very much for everything you've done. Another round of applause, please, for her. With that said, thank you to everybody who helped us with the sound and the video and all of you on Facebook who watched us. We really appreciate you paying attention and making this work. So please join us for the reception.